future? 2 months, 5 months, 1 year, 10 years? Let's see. First of all, let's go back one century. This is when our hair had a color. And so I actually thought that Peter was going to introduce me. And here we are, 60 papers together. And I was his first PhD student, like 100 years ago. And when I started giving lectures afterwards, he always came back to me, "Ben, speak slowly." So Peter, you're allowed to say that again. I'm going to have two talks, possibly for two audiences. Science for science, as we just heard, and science for society, impact. Both are important. And for me, both will drastically need to change. I think in nutrition, we're not so much on a dead end track, but it will definitely take a long, long time before we have all the missing data and all the pieces of the puzzle as we do right now, specifically when there's a lack of money and possibly interest. So I'm going to talk about new methodologies and new concepts of health and health quantification and optimization. And then I'll bring them into practice in how I see the future of nutrition. Okay. So this is what we do now. This is the largest review I've ever contributed to, like 80 pages on inflammation and childhood diseases, the INSPIRE project of Dan Rayton. And here's the list of biomarkers. And we've heard a lot about these. And all of you now think, oh, we miss data. We need more. So we go and measure. We find devices how to go into the field and all of that and all of that. And then we have the data. And then we say, now we need to supplement or we need to have better foods. But I don't think that's the way to go forward. I don't think we need to have this type of data and start working on this. And I'll explain to you. If you look at vitamin D, we know, we talk about how much vitamin D you need to eat, yeah, or supplement. And if the sun doesn't shine, we need to supplement in the Netherlands. And when it's summer, we don't need to. That's how it works. But you know, vitamin D has a number of metabolic steps. And in each of the steps, there's genetic polymorphism. And it's important because the difference between people eating the same amount and how the bioactive compound at the site of target is highly dependent on the genetics. And you see it here. Yeah, this is the LOG2 transformed 25-hydroxy vitamin D level. And you see there is a factor 2, 3, 4 difference between having no bad polymorphism, if there's anything like that, and the whole series of the 6 polymorphisms. It's not so abundant, all these 6, but this tells me that there's no, I don't need to quantify my food intake because it will be wrong anyhow. Yeah. And food intake by itself is lousy. And I'm going to talk black and white to keep you awake, okay? But even if you do it in a completely accurate manner, it's lousy because it doesn't report on what I need. And I've invented the Bao Tai principle here. Talking about individual variation and the efficacy, there's an enormous amount of individual variation in the intake for quite a number of reasons, be it the biomarker, but also the way we eat. And on the other part of the spectrum, there's a large range of late effects, yeah, the epidemiological end stages. The real thing that matters is the cross of the bow tie, the concentration of the compound at the site of action. That's what we need to measure, and that's where we need to start intervene, yeah? And that's where we become personal. So my suggestion for funders would be skip funding on food intake quantification. And for science is don't take the flight backwards and improve methods that will not work, but take the flight forwards and go measure the physiological activity of the compound that is relevant for the molecular effects. Quantify the phenotype, and from this come to dietary recommendations. Yeah, and don't talk about the phenotype when you die. Talk about the molecular phenotype which is at the crossroads over there.
Yeah.
Luckily, there's a big consortium working on that. It's the football consortium in the Netherlands. It's a joint program activity. Maybe a few of you are involved. This is the way forward. It's important. But then you have determined the on-site concentration of 25-dihydroxy vitamin D. And you think you now have the solution for example, inflammatory control. But it's not. This is a simple scheme of a literature search where we've simply looked at the human clinical intervention studies of a number of vitamins, which are the yellow ones, the micronutrients, and their effects on inflammation-related biomarkers, which are the gray ones, I think. Now, if there's a plus, it means if you increase the concentration of the micronutrient, the biomarker increases. Now, what do you see here? You see that almost all micronutrients have an effect on almost all biomarkers. There's not a single biomarker that's just acting on one micronutrient. And you also see that many micronutrients have multiple effects. It is a system. So I do systems biology, complex, you get a lot of money for it. But I appreciate it to call it system thinking. I've heard many lectures that go reductionistic today. And of course we need to, because those are the pieces of the puzzle. But we need to make the puzzle, which is the system. You cannot optimize health by adding one micronutrient. Yeah? Don't do it. Go and look for the system. Now, there's something else involved. Because if that is the case, you look at static, homeostatic, resting, fasting biomarkers. But that's not what it's all about. These micronutrients have a function. They usually are cofactors for processes. These processes have a function. They do something in your body. Inflammation is absent if it isn't necessary. But if you got an infection, or if you eat a high fatty meal, or if you get sunburn, or if you get anything like this, this is what happens. Inflammation goes up and it goes down. It needs to act. It is a stress response reaction. My physiology, my molecular machinery in here, from here to here, is completely packed with those mechanisms, stress response mechanisms. The function of this stress response is essential. We've heard this also from Louise just now. If you're on stage, cortisol is high. If you're there, cortisol is low. Mine is low now because I'm already adapted to it. Yeah, sorry? And I'm old, yeah, and I'm a male, and all of that. It's a system, there you go. But the dynamics is important, yeah? Now, this is the point. Don't measure homeostasis, but measure the time curve. Because things go bad when it's too high. And things go bad when it's too low. In terms of inflammation, yeah, either you get fever or you're not acting properly. And if it takes too long, chronic inflammation, you have a chronic inflammatory disease. Now, the point is, the point is that I need a pointer. Here. At this level, you would not measure anything because you don't have inflammation. The stress response, the system's flexibility or phenotypic flexibility is essential. Yeah? Biomarkers don't work if you measure here. Yeah? Especially when you're healthy. If you're diseased, where is it? If you're diseased, you might measure it here. Yeah? Okay, but we are thinking about optimal health. Yeah? The point is, this is a universal principle. It's valid for metabolism, for oxidative stress. It's valid for mental stress. Banks do stress tests. Yeah? And so on and so on. If you want to quantify health, quantify the stress response reaction. Now, we've done this. We've done this for micronutrients. This is, this has a story. We've done numerous studies where we've measured numerous compounds, metabolites, proteins. This is a study where we've measured 1,400 proteins as a time response to a metabolic stressor and some 400 metabolites as a time response to a metabolic stressor. And what you see here is the correlation between fasting micronutrients and the time response of many proteins and metabolites. They're here. Yeah. In other words, to what extent does the fasting level of micronutrients dictate the capacity to react? Yeah, and it does. Yeah, all of these micronutrients dictate my way to do a stress response. Yeah, so this is the proof of the pudding, in the sense that don't go and measure fasting states, but measure how the things act. Now, we've done this big scale, numerous human studies, and we've quantified thousands of metabolites and genes and all of that, and we've come up with a picture, and this is a picture. This is the picture of me. My local machinery here, my molecular physiology, of all the inflammatory and organ and metabolic processes, and all the metabolites that we, as a research kit, would propose to quantify in order to have a comprehensive picture of how this metabolic inflammatory machine room acts upon high meals and so on. Yeah, it's if we call it a FEMFLEX, phenotypic flexibility test, which is a nice mixture of proteins, lipids, and glucose. It hits the system in a standardized manner. Yeah, and you quantify all kinds of metabolites, and in this way you get a feeling, quantified feeling, of how all these organs and processes act. Yeah, so this is what you get in the end. This is this machine room in here. Yeah, and in you, and all these processes are connected one way or the other. And by using this challenge test, we can quantify the status of all of these processes. It's not a simple test. It's not an expensive test. And we are working on how to bring this into clinical practice, at least. Yeah. So measure a number of compounds. And I'll show you later on that you can actually do it already with two compounds. Now that I know how all of these components of my machinery work, it's up to me to optimize this. And this is the fun part. Nutrition actually always acts as an optimizer of these processes. In contrast to pharma, which blocks these processes, dietary components, whether they are micronutrients or essential fatty acids or polyphenols that we've just heard, they all have a function in optimizing these processes. In other words, if I know that things are wrong here, I start looking for this one. If I know that things are wrong here, I start looking for that one. Quantify the system's flexibility, and optimize this with diet. Now, of course, you don't eat this, but in Holland we eat herring, yeah? And in France you drink wine, everybody eats carrots and eggs and so on. If you're vegetarian, make another diet. You can optimize personalized diets based on a system's flexibility quantification. Yeah, sounds like science fiction, but I'll show you that this is actually done in practice. We've done a study together with this is a CorioPREF study done in Cordoba, Spain, with 1,000 patients, cardiovascular patients, that we've quantified using a stress test, a simple oral glucose tolerance test. We've given them glucose, and we've looked at the curve, the time response, and this is standardized clinical practice, yeah? An oral glucose tolerance test. If you're pregnant, you might have done one of those. If you're diabetic, for sure. No, not for sure. You might have done this. Now, depending on how this curve works, looks like, we know what organ is insulin resistant. Yeah? If you look at this one here, it's the liver. If you look at this one here, it's the muscle. Now, this study was a 5-year intervention study with two different diets, the Mediterranean diet, and a low-fat, high-fiber diet. Both are healthy for heart patients. Yeah. The interesting thing is that if you look at the subtype of person, no insulin resistance, only in the muscle, only in the liver, and both, the dietary intervention for muscle insulin resistance, in terms of the Mediterranean diet, was specifically healthy here. Yeah. So the high-fiber diet did not really act so well. It was the Mediterranean diet. If you have specific liver insulin resistance, the high fiber diet was good. Yeah, and if you're a full-blown insulin resistant diabetic, the Mediterranean diet. Now, what doctor does this test on a diabetic, on a type 2 diabetic? Nobody. What doctor would discriminate between two different diets if he thinks about optimizing, reversing the flexibility? Nobody. And I think that's a shame. I won't use the word criminal, but I think that patients are entitled to this type of treatment, yeah? And it's not expensive, it's just measuring glucose, yeah? Now, there we are. This is where we need to go to. So, we all have our dreams and goals in life, getting old, not losing hair, playing with our grandchildren, running a marathon, optimizing our blood pressure, and so on, yeah? we set personalized nutrition-based consumer goal, whether it's weight management and so on and so on. We know that there is this machinery that I've just shown you. We know that we can diagnose them in here, and in diagnosing this, we start to understand how this complexity works, and we know that the biochemistry in here is highly related to our diet. Yeah, all the machinery here is fed by different nutrients. Yeah, this is where you modulate in order to achieve this. So how does this work? Yeah, if you want to improve glucose flexibility through the liver, through insulin sensitivity, you might increase magnesium because magnesium stimulates beta cell insulin secretion. Yeah. The point, however, is if you start feeding somebody with magnesium, you also work on inflammatory control through the muscle in lipid flexibility. And the other way around, yeah, there are other compounds that also, carbs, of course, connect here. It is a system, and it's complex. You cannot just study this in observational studies without understanding the flexibility machine room. If you want to go making solutions for, and this is health goals, but you can make the same argument for medical goals, type 2 diabetes, osteoporosis. We've heard about this, yeah? I've discussed this with the osteoporosis lecture guy. What about the inflammation in there? Yeah, cardiovascular. Many inflammatory diseases and so on, neuronal diseases. The same principle. If you want to improve them here, look at the mechanism, quantify this. Okay, so we should quantify the dynamics, systems flexibility, phenotypic flexibility. We can optimize the dynamics by dietary interventions, that is to provide them with nutrients for the flexibility machinery. But there's another aspect, and I've heard this many times because I've been listening to you these 2 days. Can we optimize system flexibility by introducing dynamics? And I'll explain this to you. Yeah, this is a study that we've done, in mice, where we've given them different concentrations of cholesterol in the diet. Low cholesterol, high cholesterol, and medium level. We've quantified a number of inflammatory components, and we've quantified the formation of atherosclerosis. And the point is, you don't do that in humans so easily. Yeah. So here you see, and interestingly, we've added one group where we alternated the low and the high concentration of cholesterol in such a way that over the week's time, it had the same dose as the middle dose. Yeah. So we can compare the middle dose efficacy with the alternating high-low, which essentially should be the same. Yeah. So if it's just counting dietary intake, there should be no difference. Now, what do you see? Inflammation. The alternating diet has the same inflammation as the control, instead of, and this is the middle one, yeah? VCAM, the alternating diet has the same VCAM as the control. Plasma, SSA, same story, yeah? Here you see atherosclerosis. This is the high, is that right, yeah? This is the middle, this is alternating, this is control. It's lower, this is lower, yeah? Plaque-free segments, this one is much higher than this one, and so on. It's weird. So what am I doing? I'm eating varied. Yeah, I'm eating low, high, instead of always the same. It looks like my machine room, my capacity to adapt is constantly triggered by doing something differently. Yeah, then I need to deal with low cholesterol, then with high cholesterol. Is that a mechanism that we need to have? I just heard the story of, in the last lecture, of the switch from germ-free to bacteria in the gut. Oh, the neurons come, yeah? Neurons act on the presence of bacteria. Now, what if I would continuously switch the type of bacteria, bacterial diversity? We count diversity, but we don't look at dynamics. Would bacterial diversity, continuous variation, create a kind of rapid intervention force in my physiology by growing different types of neurons or different types of TL, toll-like receptors, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I don't want to go into the mechanisms. That's up to you. But think about the principles, yeah? Same story for metabolism. We are constantly overfeeding our system. There's never, almost never, a lack of calories. We're always in an anabolic manner. Yeah, it appears that continuous switching between low and high is utterly healthy. We start to learn the mechanisms. Yeah, we start to see how fasting or intermittent fasting or ketogenic diets revitalize mitochondria. Yeah, how alternating carb and fatty acid diets revitalize mitochondrial functions in the muscle. Yeah, this alternating aspect seems to be a universal principle of health. Yeah, this is interesting. We did another mouse study, and we measured the inflammation after after the injection of IL-1. IL-1 is an inflammatory trigger, so you should measure the reaction of inflammation in mice. This is nothing happens. This is an injection. It increases. That's what should happen. Yeah. Now then, we started to feed the mice with increasing concentration of salicylate, which is supposed to be an anti-inflammatory compound. Now this is what you see. First of all, obviously, without injection of interleukin, resting is resting. As I said, homeostatic fasting. There's no inflammation, and there's no way you can improve the absence of inflammation. Yeah. So don't do studies in this way with fasting biomarkers. Then, at higher concentration, the inflammation is lower. But the interesting part is, at low concentration, the inflammation is higher. That's weird. A compound that is known as an anti-inflammatory compound, funny enough, in the concentration that's present in highly abundant vegetables and fruits, is a pro-inflammatory compound. Could it be that those compounds pass through my intestines and tickle, stimulate, trigger an inflammatory reaction, and by doing so, train my inflammatory response so that once I really get a pathogen, I am protected because I'm trained in inflammatory response? Yeah? We call it hormesis. We laugh about it, but it's there. It's there. We've seen it, and you see it all the time. Yeah? Could it be that we are genetically wired to protect ourselves by training our defense systems? Yeah, think about this when you go and bring this into practice. And in that way, we start realizing that all these grandmothers' fairy tales, yeah, there might be some truth in it. Let's do some research on this. Yeah, is garlic really anti-inflammatory because it's pro-inflammatory? I can tell you some nice anecdotes on this. Yeah, there we go. So we come to an interesting concept. Can we improve health by challenging with unhealthy situations? Are we robust? Yeah, or are we continuously asleep in our system? Yeah, in our defense system, because there's no challenge. Yeah, how do we feed ourselves? Why does autism occur? All of a sudden, is this because in our early life, we are not varied enough in our challenges, and our system is not wired in diversity, in dynamics, and this connects up and down from gut to brain, and we get weird up here. Yeah, I'm talking strange language for you because you're a scientist and I don't know anything about it, but I see the mechanisms. Yeah, we know this for asthma, the famous studies where the diversity in exposure in microbes or fungi is correlated to the onset of, is inversely correlated to the onset of asthma. Is this diversity, this continuously changing environment? Yeah, Mark Miller had this talk and he mentioned that in India, he noted so many pathogens in young people without them being sick. Yeah, what do they do, these pathogens? If I'd go to India and drink their water, oh boy, yeah, you might have experienced it. Is this because I've never been challenged? Of course, we know that. Is this universal? Yes, it is. Yeah, and so on and so on. Now, this is interesting. It's just an anecdote to show the complexity of this. This is the connection between serious early life events and type 1 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes is an immune disease. The theory is that things start leaking through your gut and trigger the immune system, you start to break down your beta cells. Are these serious life events opening up the gut? Is there this frightening thing here that through the nervous vagus starts to open up the gut? Might be, yeah. We know the systems, we know the connections. We've heard this very elegantly in the previous talks. The systems, the system is bigger than we think. We all have our hobby, whether it is metabolic systems or bigger systems, we need to go and look into this, yeah? Now, so far for the science of science. So let's repeat. Challenge the system to quantify it. Find nutrient solutions that optimize the machinery that makes this flexibility. And possibly, we need to really think about interventions or lifestyles that train our flexibility, possibly by continuously varied exposure. Now, I've heard a lot about these nasty organizations that don't allow us to label our compounds and have a barrier between food and drugs and so on. But essentially what they are doing is they protect us. They are consumer protection organizations. You might like this or not, but this is where we are. We are in a public health world where we have organizations that protect silly, stupid consumers because they cannot choose for themselves. And you hear what I'm saying, eh? Can we come to a society where we don't need protection and where we are empowered because we know what to choose for? Aha, that's interesting. Now, the Dutch people understand this. It says boodschap. Boodschap is an app. Yeah, so the non-Dutch speaking people understand the second part, app. Yeah, but it means a shopping app. So this is a shopping app. It's been in the Netherlands for a few years, then they went bankrupt. What did it do? Genius. It was a shopping app, of course. So what you did is, and I'm sorry, Maureen, but you've gone already, so I can repeat it. You go shopping with your cell phone. Yeah, if you have two kids with you, you're not able to do this. You read the barcode, yeah? And the telephone tells you, I have a cheaper one for you, or a more sustainable one, or hypothesis, one that's exactly fitting your phenotype or your health goal. And when this came out, the Dutch food companies got scared because all of a sudden they thought, advertising is not going to work anymore if they are going to read the message on my phone. The question is, where does the message come from? Is it good? Is it reliable? And all of that. But this is the point, yeah? So, do you want to have the advertising or do you want to have the barcode? I can scan a product and the app tells me if this is the right product for me based on my preferences. Cheap, healthy, biological, sustainable, and so on, yeah? What is it based on? It's based on simple things. I type in, I want to have biological food, yeah? So it tells you this is not biological, easy, yeah? But what if we could start feeding our personal health data or our personal health goals in there? And this app would tell me, take the other one, yeah? I don't need consumer protection, I'm empowered, yeah? We are now heading towards a society where data, my data, becomes a powerful tool to guide myself. Now, how does that work? Yeah, how will nutrition look like in 10 years? Yeah, so first of all, you know, I don't know whether this is 10 years or 2 years or 20, but for me, this is not a matter of if, but it's a matter of when. Yeah, and you'll see it. So this is scary for food companies if you don't change your business model. Stay awake for another 50 minutes. It's personal, yeah? If you want to lose weight, you need to eat less calories. But sometimes it's more complicated. Sometimes you need a proper diagnosis. Blood pressure, you don't see blood pressure from your face. You need to measure something. Who knows his own blood pressure or her own blood pressure? Are you acting on it? Yeah? So there is this diagnosis intervention combination, yeah? Sometimes it's more complicated, yeah, than just doing your 10,000 steps a day. Sometimes you need models. You need data that is brought into a model, an algorithm, a decision tree, or whatever, that starts telling you what your advice is. Yeah. sometimes it gets really complicated, or sometimes you just don't want to have advice on everything, but just on a specific goal. So the model is fed from a toolbox with many other models. And this model, of course, is knowledge-based, yeah, and all of that. Now, the point, of course, is, and this is the funny part here, if I start acting on this and I start collecting my data, and I don't need to do this actively because my phone just keeps track on it, or something else keeps track on it. Science fiction. Don't tell me that your phone doesn't do it. It does, yeah? You might not know it, and so on. And in 10 years, it will do a lot more, and you'll know a lot more. So what if I do this, and I improve health, and a lot of other people do this, and the data of all these other people becomes available to feed the algorithms that advise me, yeah? So this is how it works. This is me, diagnosis, intervention, communication. Milieu, think about your part here. You do diagnosis, yeah? Nestle, think about your part here. You make products. Together, it's a service. It's not a product anymore, it's a service. We will change from a product-oriented society to a service-oriented society, and it will be driven by data, yeah? So here I go, and then I start doing it, and I start making regular adjustments on my diet. And of course, you'll say, I don't do this because I just want to eat what I like, but companies will find a way, yeah? This timeline is repeated by many others, and I start making, using algorithms, and we do this right now, it's not science fiction, we do this right now, that start acting on all of these changes. It's not nudging, it's science. It's science-based advice based on many. I call this big data embedded NS1. How do you do this? Now, this is a child health conference, so I need to say something about children. True, eh? Few slides on this. So this is a child health passport. It's written, yeah? And if you start looking around, there are not many countries that have this. Yeah, some others keep track of this. In the Netherlands, we have an app, yeah, where you can follow the growth of your child in all of this. And actually, Tino makes this. Yeah, Tino makes the, for almost 50 years already, the growth curves. Yeah, and it's monitoring. Yeah, so now I can see, is the head of my baby too small or too big? And then, if it's too big, what do? Make the body larger, make the head smaller. What type of intervention can you do on this type of monitoring? Yeah? Think about it. It's funny, but it's also sad. Yeah? So we are monitoring because of the statistics. Yeah? And I've asked some mothers, what would you change the food of your baby or of your first or of your the first foods based on what you know? Can we? Do we have the tools? I'm not sure. We can measure so much, yeah? Cognitive tests. And actually, this is being done. Most of this is being done in the Netherlands. Cognitive tests, growth curves. You can do genetics. I call this diaperomics, yeah? So these are diapers. Yeah, that's the only non-invasive omics that you can do in children, yeah? And we do this, yeah? Big scale by now. There's child medication, parent observations. Can we bring this together in something like a child biopassport in an electronic manner and start acting on it? That is, what type of interventions? So now what do? We think we need more vitamin B12, or we need more omega-3 fatty acids, DHA. This is public health, it's not personalized health, yeah? What do you, parent, observe in your baby that becomes actionable, and what child food industry acts upon this by making this possible? You don't do this now, but in 10 years you'll do it. So prepare for it, yeah? So this is what happens now with our medical records. It's there, yeah? It's not accessible. Last Monday, the Dutch Minister of Health made the announcement that he provides. First he said, your medical data is your ownership. You own it. We know it's not possible, but you own it. So I'll spend $3 million on a project next year, to make you own this, yeah? Interesting. So what if I own my own health data? For one thing, it's extremely valuable. Yeah, IBM hunts for your data. It's their business models. Anybody here from IBM? No, so I can continue. No, joking. I don't want to have them have my data. I once gave my DNA to a company. Yeah, 23andMe. who did this? There you go. They have become filthy rich with your data. Yeah, they made an enormous contract, I think, with Genentech, and they got 150 million for my data. When I read this, I went back to the website and I unticked the box, you can use my data for anything you like. Yeah, not because I don't think it's good science, but because I think I own this value. This is my data. So how do we organize ourselves in such a manner that my health data valorizes for me? I don't want to be rich. Well, I want to be rich, but not with my health data, but I want to be healthy. Yeah. So how do you do this? Yeah. And so on. This is the new wave of data technology. People ask for your data and they become rich. This is very simplistic manner, but that's how it works. Yeah. We have now created the Holland Health Data Cooperative. What's that? It's all of us together that have our health data, whether it be your genome or your body weight. And we say, let's own this together and let's valorize this together. We own this cooperative, yeah? And together we set up a structure that negotiates with the supermarket. If I give you my data, do you give me my food? Yeah? And I want to have discounts specifically for the food that fits my health goals. Yeah, interesting. If indeed there's so much value, and this is all, it's still in the diapers, yeah? But it will get there, yeah? And we are building it now. Last year, we have set up this, the Holland Health Data Cooperative, and it starts to interact with all kinds of data users. And in between here, there are services, because who translates my data into what type of service? Let's talk about that. So this is what we've built, the TNO Life Companion. Here you see the same figure. Yeah, here you see how, in this case, an app, but it can be a screen, it can be a life coach, I don't care, where you continuously do new diagnosis, and continuously get new advice. This is done by many people. The data is owned by all of us. It's in a health data cooperative, which is both a legal entity and an IT infrastructure. And this is interesting. Health data services. Who here starts to act upon this data? Who provides this advice? Is it me? Yeah, at this moment it's me, it's Tino. But I foresee a big new industry that starts acting on this manner. Yeah, this is the industry of 10 years, after 10 years. Not now. It is a shift from products to services. I see you as industry acting on this. Some of them try it out, make reports. Some of them make stealth startups and do this in a way. Some of them buy companies. We are going there. Yeah, this is what we are trying at the moment in the Netherlands. Yeah, we talk to health insurance. We build all of this. We connect to all of these services. And I do this within the healthcare, by the way. I'm curing type 2 diabetics. So this is serious business because I think that's where food has a major role. Yeah, why do you not cure people with lifestyle that have become ill because of a lifestyle? Think about the flexibility. If you restore flexibility, you restore health. Yeah. So this is how it helps. Yeah. Do your diagnosis. Get into this trajectory. Get your biopassport with full health data ownership. A new health economy starts providing services on what I want to do with it. And interestingly, if you have such a big data pool, and you do this properly, this data pool is richer than Framingham, Epic, and whatever cohort you name. Yeah? So we can start doing research on this. So all of a sudden, this cooperative starts negotiating with me as a scientist. Hey, did you need some data? What is it worth for you? What type of algorithms do I get in return? Or advice systems, or money, or whatever? Yeah? The value of health data is enormous. We need to exploit this in a new industry. He's laughing at me, Dr. Van Bladeren. At least I'm talking slowly. This is part of a big system. We've heard this a number of times. Yeah? It's not just the individual. Social, cultural, community, environment, agricultural, markets, governmental, global. I can tell you to stop eating glucose, but if we have an agriculture industry that only produces glucose, we have a problem here. Yeah, and there'll be resistance. I can start telling you not swallowing drugs because they won't cure you, but if we have an industry that makes a lot of money on this, we have an issue. Yeah. So all of this needs to change. We have a system. So this is what we do in the Netherlands. This is a part of the Netherlands. TNO is here. We have formed an alliance with Leiden University Medical Center, and we've said we are going to implement this in the Hague, Rotterdam, Leiden area. The funny thing is that almost all of our vegetables are produced here, the Westland. Yeah, if you fly over it, it's all greenhouses. How can local producers, based on the biopassport of people in The Hague, start building a new economy here and here? Yeah, interesting. This is what we're doing now. And I think it works. Yeah. So we come to a position where we have a big knowledge of ourselves and we are acting on personalized nutrition and personalized medicine in the same manner. Yeah. But we're also doing something else. In the same time, we are connecting, integrating research and healthcare. Because if this is about me, and I forgot to tell you, back to The Hague. The people here that form this health data community are member of themselves. Yeah. And we connect to them. So we ask them, you have an issue with this. Now we have an intervention that we can do. What about if you will try this on yourself? Anyhow, the system of bookkeeping, the biomarkers and the data infrastructure is there. So we can do nested intervention studies, and we're doing this. In this cohort, we only guarantee that they'll be better off, that they valorize their participation in becoming healthier if they're not the placebo group. Yeah, I'll give you an example. We are now going to use an online glucose monitoring, continuous glucose monitoring that lasts for 150 days. And we're asking the community here, are you willing to use this? And we'll give you advice based on your continuous glucose monitoring. I'm talking about type 2 diabetics. So the point is that healthcare and research start merging. Yeah, we don't have cohorts that you cannot cure, and we don't have healthcare where we cannot do research. It merges. Yeah, so all of a sudden we come to a completely new situation where personal health data, interventions, diagnostics, e-health, service economy, research are fully integrated. Talking about the future of nutrition. Ha! Now, the internet is full of nice pictures, yeah, about innovations and disruptors. This is my one. Yeah, so this is where we are now here. Smart homes, genomics, we did all of that, drones. Yeah, we're now climbing up here. In my view, personal health data valorization is a disruptor and will make it like this. And in my view, a systems approach, a strategy, is the way to go forward. These two combined will shape this new future. Now, this is a scary one. This is Amazon. Amazon is going to do this, obviously. Last month, they've already announced how they will enter healthcare. Amazon has 840,000 employees. Yeah, and they will use them as guinea pigs to see how they can make a healthcare part. Yeah, provision of drugs, provision of lifestyle. They know already everything about you. Yeah, if you give them your health data, they'll just expand the new economy. This is what's going to happen. Yeah, my invitation to all of us is this up to Amazon or is this up to everybody? Is this about getting very rich as stakeholders or is this about valorization of ourselves? Yeah, think about it. Now, in order to make sure that I have a very personal interest in child health, and this is my granddaughter. She's 1.5 years old. And I'll tell you, there's genetics involved because once I have drunken my cup of Nespresso, she comes and with her finger licks the Nespresso. Thank you very much.